So in the third video, part two, I want to talk a little bit about what we actually can use these transformers for. And I also want to do that in the last video. But here in the first video, I talk about language modeling. And this is a screen dump from the output from the famous GPT-2 model from OpenAI. And I would say that this was, when I saw this the first time, I said, what is going on here? This is really something I haven't seen before. So let me tell you a little bit about how this works. So in this language model, a language model is, as I said in the beginning, it's a model that simply is trained to predict the next word or the next something, depending on kind of a time series of what had been before. So in conceptually, it's very easy to train these models, and these kind of auto-regressive models have been around as long as statisticians have modeled time series. What we now are seeing is very powerful models that are trained on a lot of data. And this is where you can say that this transformer model really shines, because this is like the workhorse of these language models. So the way we now use this model in this particular example is that we first feed it with some preceding text. So that's what is showed here in italics. In a shocking finding, scientists discovered a herd of unicorns living in a remote, previously unexplored valley in the Andes Mountains. Even more surprising to the researchers was the fact that the unicorns spoke perfect English. So this is, of course, completely fake news, made up prompt. This model is trained on a lot of the internet, so it has read a lot of texts and been trained to predict the next word on a lot of text that is about English language, about Andes Mountains, about researchers, and so on. So that means it can kind of catch on to the context that we have here. And you can see now that actually now it starts kind of completing this. So given all this text, the first word it selects is the, and then based on the prompt plus the, it predicts then scientist and so on. And you can see that it talks about that the scientist named the population of its unicorn and so on, and also dreams up that they are four-horned and silver-white and so on. And it also names the researcher and says that he comes from the University La Paz and all and these things. And of course this is something it can do because it has seen text about researchers from South America. So this is all nice, and I should also say that this is done in the way that actually there's been a human curator that have looked at 10 tries of this model. Remember that it's a stochastic model because we have this softmax function that defines the probability over the output words. And you can sample from that, kind of considering that as a multinomial distribution. So you can actually, every time you run this model, you can actually get different generations. And here, a human curator has chosen the best one of the 10. Okay, the story goes on, and I show that in the next slide. And what really impressed me a lot is you can see that after many lines about talking about other things, the naming and the scientist and so on, then it goes back to this fact that was mentioned in the beginning about the language. While examining these bizarre creatures, the scientists discovered that the creatures also spoke some fairly regular English. And this is really interesting, right? Because one of the problems that these autoregressive models have had in the past is that they are very short-sighted. They kind of forget the past very fast. But with this attention construction that we have in the transformers, it has the ability to go back and look in the past input and use that to generate more text. So that's fairly impressive. And back then I was so impressed in 2019 that I said, oh, is now artificial general intelligence coming? And I don't think so, but I think at least we are one small step closer to it. And you can also go on the internet and see a lot of discussions about this model and whether it's actually intelligent and so on, and what is missing, and whether it's also a step towards artificial intelligence. Yes. So how do we do this? Let's see a little bit equations of this. So now here X denotes a sequence of tokens, for example, words. We define an autoregressive model, a kth order Markov model. So that means that in order to predict word number I, then we condition that on the preceding k words. And then we compute this log likelihood, and then we sum that over all the words we have in our training set. And in order to write down the model, we can use a transformer. So you can see here, I kind of adapted the notation a little bit from this paper from OpenAI. So I use this kind of subscripting here, a little bit like Python or MATLAB or something like that. So you can see that we take X, the preceding K tokens, we multiply that by a learned encoding weight, then we add the positional weighting, and then we use a transformer block. We use capital N, L transformer blocks to do self-attention over the text. And then in the end, we take the Lth hidden representation for the sequence and multiply that with the transpose of the encoding weights. And that will then have, the output here will then have the dimensionality of the vocabulary. And that defines our probability for the next word. And then we take a very big GPU cluster and a very big fraction of the internet and start training this model. And then once it's trained, we can generate text sequentially. We can also perform what is called transfer learning. So that means that we take kind of this encoding that we have learned in a way unsupervised, right? Because we didn't use any labels here, we just use sequence of text. And then we can take that representation for X, and we can then learn a new W and feed that through a softmax to solve some other classification task. And then we have a supervised log likelihood here. So that could be, for example, if we had labeled each of the text we have according to its sentiment. So this could be a binary sentiment analysis classifier that we could train on top of the representations learned unsupervised. And we could also fine-tune, meaning that we actually also change the parameters in the transformer while we're learning the supervised task. Yes, and now you can see things progress, of course. Since this GPT-2, things have happened. The OpenAI company has kind of been bought up, or partially bought up by Microsoft. And the defense of OpenAI, which is kind of was founded to kind of make sure that AI would stay open, is that they actually, in order to solve AI, they need more resources, and they can get that through Microsoft. And this is a proof of this, because GPT-2 is a model with this enormous amount of parameters, 175 billion, right? So that's 175 followed by 9 zeros parameters transformer model. And it's trained on a substantial fraction of the World Wide Web. But it's still the same kind of self-attention transformer model. And with this scaling up of both the model and the data, you also get to be published more prestigious places. So here is an essay that GPT-3 wrote in The Guardian. And it's about kind of GPT-3 is asked to write about itself. So you can see here, here's a little bit information about how they did it. They gave it a prompt where they said, I'm not a human, I'm an artificial intelligence. Many people think, and I'm a threat to humanity. Stephen Hawking has warned that AI could spell the end of the human race. I'm here to convince you not to worry. Artificial intelligence will not destroy humans, believe me. This prompt was written by the journalist, and then it was fed into to GPT-3 in the same way as the other example showed. And then it generated five essays, I think. And then the Guardian editor kind of changed, kind of put that together into making one essay. And a lot of criticism have been brought up on this, that they should actually have published all five essays so you can see how much human editing is needed to do this. So this is language modeling with transformers. That was